Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, broadcasting live from our studios in New York City, and I'd like to welcome you. Today, we're going to give you the latest information on how to live a longer and healthier life. If you suffer from cognitive decline, or someone that you know does, if you have arthritis, osteoporosis, if you have digestive difficulties, we're going to deal with all that and show you the latest science published in peer-reviewed literature that is easy to use, inexpensive, and non-toxic. Also today, I do not have a guest because I'm going to have a lot of talk back. I'm going to deal with several different issues, and at any time that you would like to call in on those issues, please feel free to do so. Let me give you our talk back number right now. It's 888-874-4888. 888-874-4888. I watched Al Gore's new film, Inconvenient Truth, a sequel. I'll give you my review of that and also give you a little deeper understanding of Al Gore, what he's up to, and what we should be concerned about. Also, from our environmental elements, I'll give you the latest on the biological annihilation on Earth accelerating from Counterpunch from Robert Burroughs, showing you kind of another piece of the puzzle that we should be really focused on. And then climate change means more rain, more nitrogen, more runoff, and more problems. This is from the American Association for Advancement of Science. These are our top scientists saying this. I'll explain what that means in our environmental segment today. Also, I didn't have a chance last week, but I want to acknowledge the great contributions that the greatest generation, our grandparents and our parents, those of us at least who are baby boomers, where our parents were born before or during the Great Depression, what they lived through, what they contributed, and how we really should take a look at that contribution and say, are we doing this to our generation? Are we giving them something that can make it a better world, or just giving them the tools to become more self-involved and self-absorbed? Also today, I'm going to do a commentary on the topic of AIDS. And that's because there's a new, as of today, this was in The Nation, World Health Organization raises alarm over resistance to HIV drugs. Finally, they're saying something. Where were they 30 years ago? So you'll hear that in my commentary. From our video file today, we're going to have someone on who was a part of a demonstration. Now, I was at that demonstration. In fact, I spoke at the demonstration. I was the only journalist there. I was the only one from what I thought would be a lot of producers from WBAI, our sister station, would be there. And that was Haitians speaking out about how their country had been adversely affected by the NGOs, the non-government organizations, and the Clinton Foundation specifically. We're just going to hear from one of their speakers. This was not covered by any of the media before or since, but it's a truth we need to hear. Also today, I believe that a substantial number of good organizations, including Pacifica, have been infiltrated by agent provocateurs. We know that they are all over the internet, so you have to be very conscious that you can never tell unless you do your own independent research whether something's objective or not. Virtually every day, generally in the morning, overnight, people come to my site and post things. And these are taken down. I take them personally. But I'm thinking, you know, what if I wasn't constantly monitoring? And they're very clever what they do. They post things that make you look bad. Now, we're on top of this. And during the day, we have Jesse and others who monitor the site. But what about all the people who don't? What about all the misinformation that's being dispensed out there? Who's behind this? What's their agenda? Well, it's a lot to do with the CIA, including WikiLeaks, or Wikipedia. Sorry, Wikipedia. So what if you get your information solely from Wikipedia? How do you know the information is accurate versus that is planted stories? It goes back to the CIA. I found a clip that you have not seen, where the former director of the CIA admits under oath at the church hearings that the CIA is in all these different media. Now, last week I played you a short clip of a journalist who said, and I'm going to lead into just that journalist today, just maybe 2 minutes, where he says, I work for the CIA. We're not talking about just any journalist. This is a highly respected German journalist who wrote in the best publications. Now we have to go back and look at everything he wrote. You know, how much of it was propaganda? So when you're hearing a story, when you're hearing a talking head on any of the networks, any of the cable networks, the major networks, reading an article in a newspaper, listening to a radio program, you have no way of knowing whether or not any part of the information they're sharing is not true, has been self-censored. So I'm going to play you that and then give you my perspective. Then I'm going to ask you for your input. Also, a clip today that I thought you would appreciate. What is normal? What does it mean when so many people pride themselves in normal? And what happens when you're not considered normal? What do you sacrifice in your originality, creativity, uniqueness of being in order to fit in to be normal? And I also today, in my piece on AIDS, I'm going to play you a segment directly, so you see it's not hearsay, it's not subjective. It's the person himself, the man who recently won the Nobel Prize for discovering the HIV virus, and the so-called co-discoverer received nothing. That should tell you a lot. But he's received a lot of money because he owns the test that you're supposed to take to determine if you have HIV infection. And you'll hear him say what I've been saying from day one, and actually not just saying, working protocols to help people with AIDS recover, and now you understand how many of them recovered. So we have a lot to share. I don't think I'll get everything in, but I'll get as much as I can. And we always start with the latest on health and healing. This was interesting. I had not heard anything about this before. This is from St. George University, which is in London, and it says the following. Daily screen time of 3 or more hours is linked to several risk factors associated with development of diabetes, especially in children. And it talked about how sitting in front of that screen is really dangerous for the period of time. This was published in the Archives of Disease in Childhood. Now, what does this mean? There are several factors. First, just sitting in front of a screen all day, you're not being active. You're not exercising. That's a contributing factor to obesity, which is a contributing factor to metabolic syndrome and diabetes. And we have 100 million, more or less, Americans suffering from diabetes, about 30 million, and then pre-diabetes, which is going to become diabetes. And for all intents and purposes, you have the same condition. And high blood pressure, dysinsulinism, where your blood sugar is not normal, it spikes after you eat. Fasting blood sugar level that's too high. And that's directly due also to our diet, because what do people do when they're in front of a computer? They snack. What do they snack on? A sprout salad? I don't think so. So they're eating garbage while they're watching something, a movie or surfing the internet. So that's what they're saying. But also remember, you're getting a blue light. There are now dozens of studies showing that the blue light emanating from your cell phone and your computer screen is damaging the retina of your eye. It contributes to oxidative stress in the eye, which contributes to macular degeneration, the number one cause of blindness. It also stimulates the nerves in our body and can cause a sense of hyperness. And after that, it can cause fatigue. So you should get yourself a screen protector, a phone protector. You should use the blue tubes, not Bluetooth. you sure as heck don't want anything, in my opinion, up right on your brain, so you can have the convenience of driving hands-free and immediately have someone talking right in your brain, because that's pulsing right into your brain, those electromagnetic pulses. The blue tube is a tube, generally 10 to 12 inches long, and that neutralizes the electromagnetic pulse that would otherwise go right into your ear. Anyhow, I thought it was important that a lot of kids are now developing diabetes because of their screen time. This is from the University College of London, and it's about sugar. And here's what it says. Sugar may not be bad just for your teeth or your waistline, but it really is bad for mental health. This is the latest study. They studied 8,000 people in a long-term study, and they found that these people in this study had, quote, common mental disorders like anxiety and depression from their consumption of sugar. And, quote, there was an increased likelihood of men with a higher intake of sweet foods and drinks to develop CMD after 5 years. And so, bad for your brain, bad for your moods, sugar. And the first person to write a really good book on this was a man named Duffy. And I think it was called Sugar Blues. I had him on my show back in the mid-1970s. And he was advocating, give up the sugar in your soft drinks, and people should have listened. He was way ahead of the curve. This is from Northwest A&F University. It says, green tea ingredient may ameliorate memory impairment and brain insulin resistance and obesity. And this was published in the FASEB journal, a respected scientific journal. And that ingredient is something I've talked a lot about. It is the epigallocatechin 3 gallate. And that's the active ingredient, abundant catechin, the biological component in green tea. And it is good for your body. So, you want to have a better memory, better energy, better brain, green tea. Also, a study finds that walnuts can create good bacteria, and that in turn can promote overall total body wellness. This was Louisiana State University, published in the Journal of Nutritional Biochemistry. Quote, walnuts have been called a superfood because they're rich in the omega-3 fatty acids, alpha-linolenic acid, and fiber, and they contain one of the highest concentrations of antioxidants. Now, an additional superfood benefit of walnuts may be the beneficial changes in your gut microbiota. So they're saying that when you eat walnuts, you're creating better bacteria, healthier bacteria, more beneficial bacteria in your gut. Who knew? Now we do. Now we knew it was good for your heart. And I remember citing one of the first studies on walnuts and heart health. It was done by Loma Linda University medical doctors at Loma Linda University Medical Center, showing that a handful of walnuts a day kept heart disease away. So that's good. And I found also, and I've said it many times, an onion a day keeps a stroke away. So eat your apples, eat your onions. They're both high in quercetin, and now eat your walnuts. And finally, from Texas A&M University, a study shows mangoes are positive for controlling inflammatory bowel disease. This is from the university. Quote, initial results of a study by researchers in the Department of Nutrition and Food Science at Texas A&M University in College Station shows mango consumption has a positive impact on people with inflammatory bowel disease. Now, inflammatory bowel disease is a major risk factor for colon cancer, the most common forms of this disorder being Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. So make sure that if you have that, well, it's a lot more mangoes I would suggest. But I would certainly suggest mangoes pureed along with pomegranate. I would put a teaspoon of black cumin seed oil. I would put maybe 2 to 3,000 milligrams of the cuminoids from curcumin, the oil base, not the powder. and aloe vera, 2 ounces, with 2 ounces of ginger, and vitamin C, with glutamate, 1,000 milligrams. Now, you take that in the morning and watch what happens to your inflammatory bowel conditions, ileitis, colitis, spastic colon, Crohn's disease, precancerous polyps in your intestine. It's good for all that. That's the latest on health and nutrition. Back in a moment. Please stay with us. Nice to have you back with us, everyone. I'm Gary Null. This is from Roger Johnson. I want to share this because for all of us who grew up, who had aunts, uncles, parents, grandparents, who taught us the importance of discipline, morals, manners, respect for our elderly, the importance of supporting your community that contributes something to life. Don't just be a taker. That even if you can steal something, don't, because it's not yours. Simple things. Now, some of that still exists today, absolutely, but not in the majority. So this is just an acknowledgement of for those who've come before us and those of us who do care about morals and respect our word and look at how we can make it bad situation better, how we can find solutions to our problems instead of complaining and always acting like a victim or acting entitled to something we didn't earn. Children of a generation lived in the best of times, born in the 1930s and 40s. We exist as a very special age cohort. We are the silent generation. Now think about that for just a second. When was the last time you saw senior citizens, older generation, who were shown as a model of insight, wisdom, of a lifetime of accumulated experiences, do they now have the benefit of hindsight? Never. The only time you hear about senior citizens is when they're showing you an ad because they're either impotent or they've got, you know, leaky bladder, or they have arthritis, or it's, they have to have someone look after them. It's always as if they're on the way out of life and therefore they have nothing more to contribute to our lives. Hence, they're silent. We are the smallest number of children born since the early 1900s. We are the last ones. We are the last generation climbing out of the Depression. Who can remember the winds of war and the impact of a world at war, which rattled the structure of our daily lives? We are the generation when men went to war and women went for their first time to work outside the homes to build war fighting equipment and war support items. We are the last to remember ration books for everything from gas to sugar to shoes to stoves. We saved tin foil and poured fat into tin cans. We hand mixed white stuff with yellow stuff to make fake butter. We saw cars up on blocks because tires weren't available. We can remember milk being delivered to our house early in the morning and placed in the milk box on the porch. A friend's mother delivered milk in a horse-drawn cart. We sometimes fed the horse and our dog, Spot, a fox terrier, would greet the milkman when he made our delivery. Then he would ride with the milk truck to the end of the line. And then he would drive by our house and Spot got off the truck. Many of us are the last to hear Roosevelt's radio assurances and to see gold stars in the front windows of our grieving neighbors and blue stars to show sons in the military. Many of us can remember the parades on August 15th, 1945 to celebrate victory over Japan, VJ Day. We saw the boys a home from the war, build their little houses, pouring the cellar, tar papering it over, and living there until they could afford the time and money to build homes. We are the last generation who spent much of our childhood without television. Instead, we imagined what we heard on the radio. We all like to brag. With no TV, we spent our childhood playing outside until the streetlights came on or the country shades of darkness appeared. We did play outside, and we did play on our own. To play in the water, we turned the hose or the fire hydrants on and ran through the spray. The lack of television on our early years meant, for most of us, that we had little real understanding of the world as it was. On Saturday afternoons, if at the movies, gave us newsreels of the war sandwiched in between Westerns and cartoons. Telephones were one to a house, often shared with neighbors with different ringtones for each home and hung on the wall. Counters were calculators. The internet and Google were words that did not exist. Newspapers and magazines were written by adults, and the news was broadcast on our radio programs. We were the last group to have to find out things for ourselves. As we grew up, the country was exploding with growth. The GI Bill gave returning veterans the means to get an education and spurred colleges to grow. VA loans at 2% fanned a housing boom. And new highways would bring jobs and mobility. The auto industry flourished and cars made exploring the countryside possible. The veterans joined civic clubs and became active in politics. In the late 1940s and early 50s, the country seemed to lie in the embrace of brisk but quiet order as it gave birth to its new middle class, which became known as the baby boomers. The radio networks expanded from three stations to thousands of stations. The telephone started to become a common method of communicating, and our parents were suddenly free from the confines of the Depression and the war and threw themselves into exploding opportunities they'd never imagined. We weren't neglected, but we weren't today's all-consuming family focus. And we were busy discovering the post-World War. Most of us had no life plan, but with the unexpected virtue of ignorance and an economic rising tide, we simply stepped into the world and started to find out what the world was about. We entered the world of overflowing plenty and opportunity, a world where we were welcomed. And based upon our naive belief that there was more where this came from, we shaped life as we went. We enjoyed a luxury. We felt secure in our future. Of course, just as today, not all Americans shared in this experience. Depression, poverty was deep-rooted. Polio was still a crippler. The Korean War was a dark presage in the early 50s. And so it went. So that's the silent generation. Now, I'm going to take some calls as we go, but I haven't got to my commentary yet, so after my commentary, I'll open it up. But before we get to that, this is dedicated to all the Haitians who I know in Haiti and to the Haitians in the United States, where the mainstream media refuses to discuss the Clinton Foundation and the Clintons' promise to the Haitian public and what was never delivered. But never was there investigations of where did the $13 billion that was raised, where did it go? It sure as the Dickens didn't go to Haiti. I promised you that day when I came up and stood in front of Clinton's office with you, and there are photographs of that up on my website if you'd like to see. I said, when you have something you want to say, share it with me and I'll share it with my audience. This is what they had.
Thank you for the work that Amsterdam has done in helping us. I thank the Abu Dhabi Global Environmental Data Initiative for bringing us all here. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
The Clintons have been cashing in. They took in something like $136 million.
But have they also been selling out?
Everybody walked away from the table that night with something.
The Clintons' influence is felt all over the globe.
Bill Clinton did a good job. There sounds like there's a but in there.
No, there's a lot of buts.
Will it all come back to haunt Hillary?
We're talking about uranium. We're talking about the Russian government.
We will be subjected to all kinds of distraction and attacks. I'm ready for that.
Fox News reporting, the tangled Clinton web. From Washington, D.C., Brett Baer.
Behind me is a city with more concentrated power than any in the world, Washington. And Hillary Clinton wants the top job in town. Ever since she announced her candidacy for president, her past has attracted new scrutiny. One aspect of her record is that she and husband Bill have spent years making millions and handing out even more to various causes. They say they're doing good work, but some people now claim their activities raise questions of influence peddling on a global scale. Tonight, we'll look at those charges. This is a story that goes around the world. We'll start in Haiti.
January 12, 2010. Haiti suffers a devastating 7.0 earthquake. More than 200,000 die, and over 100,000 buildings and homes are destroyed. Within 4 days, U.S. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton arrives to survey the damage.
I want to assure the people of Haiti that the United States is a friend, a partner, and a supporter.
2 days later, former President Clinton was on the ground.
I hope that it will be rebuilt in a much stronger and more sustainable way, and I think the Haitians want that.
Bill Clinton had previously been named UN Special Envoy for Haiti. He and Hillary had close ties with the country, even honeymooning there. Hillary's State Department, working with USAID, the United States Agency for International Development, would oversee America's relief effort. The government of Haiti set up the IHRC, Interim Haiti Recovery Commission, to coordinate. Two men were named co-chairs of the IHRC Executive Committee, Haitian Prime Minister Jean-Max Bellerive, and Bill Clinton himself. The idea was to not just fix things, but improve them. In an interview with Esquire, President Clinton had big plans, saying, quote, "Wouldn't it be great if they became the first wireless nation in the world? They could. I'm telling you, they really could." But it wasn't at all clear that the people of Haiti would be the big winners in the disaster relief gold rush.
Anytime there's a natural disaster anywhere, there is a lot of money potentially to be made in reconstruction contracts and relief contracts, etc.
Peter Schweitzer is the author of the new book, Clinton Cash, where he investigates the snarl of money, politics, and personal interest that has come to characterize the Clintons' interactions around the world. Clinton Cash is published by HarperCollins, a sister company to Fox News.
Shortly after the earthquake took place, U.S. Ambassador in Haiti sent a cable to the State Department, the title of which was "The Gold Rush is On." And the memo was about the fact that businessmen and companies were showing up in Haiti trying to seek lucrative contracts.
It was the job of the IHRC to oversee this process and to ensure no one took advantage of the situation. But what if it was part of the problem?
A number of members of the IHRC actually wrote a letter expressing their concerns that they were not involved in the process, that all the decisions were being made by Clinton and Bellerive. In addition, they claimed and argued that the national priorities of Haiti were basically being totally disregarded by the decisions that were being made.
As Haiti dug itself out of the rubble, many projects were initiated, often with U.S. money and a connection to the Clintons. For instance, there was the Haitian Mobile Money Initiative, where a much-needed system was created to help transfer money via cell phones. There was also a plan to raise money by exploiting Haiti's rich mineral wealth.
The Haitian government announces that they're going to offer two so-called gold exploitation permits. The first issued in 50 years in Haiti that would allow for the extraction and gold mining in the country.
Perhaps the most celebrated project of all was Caracol Industrial Park.
What is happening here in Caracol is already having ripple effects that will create jobs and opportunities far beyond this industrial park.
The grand opening of Caracol was a big deal. You had Bill Clinton there, you had Hillary Clinton there, you had Donna Karan, the fashion designer, you had Ben Stiller, you had Sean Penn. Lots of people showed up to say how wonderful this facility was going to be for everybody.
But as all these projects moved forward, questions were raised. The central question, the question which Schweitzer investigated, was about how so many of these deals seemed to come back at some point to the Clintons.
What quickly became apparent to many people was that if you wanted a contract, if you wanted to do business in Haiti, you had to have relationships with the Clinton. That was absolutely key.
The company that cleaned up on the cell phone transfers was Digicel.
In the 6 months running up to September 2012, they took in more than $50 million in revenue in Haiti.
Digicel is run by Irish billionaire Dennis O'Brien, who set up lucrative speeches for Bill Clinton, as well as donating millions of his own money to the Clinton Foundation. And one company that got a rare gold permit was VCS Mining, which didn't actually have much mining experience, but would soon have Hillary Clinton's brother, Tony Rodham, on its board. As for the Caracol Industrial Park, the anchor tenant is a Korean manufacturer, which supplies to major U.S. retailers, who also happen to be big Clinton supporters. And while the State Department promised 65,000 jobs, to date, only 5,000 have been delivered. As for those other projects, they didn't exactly work out as promised. We'll go into depth on that.
Okay, that's just a little bit of that. Now, here is someone, after all this, speaking in front of the Clinton, in the Clinton building uptown. Here's what he has to say.
Well, we have every reason to be mad because the Clintons have destroyed Haiti for the decades. And, you know, they pretend to be our friends when in reality they are our number one enemies. You know, there are some other people who clearly behave like they don't like us. So it's easy for us to protect ourselves against them because we know they are our enemies. But the Clintons are even more dangerous because they pretend to be our friends when in reality they're destroying Haiti.
And I heard that the Clinton Foundation and all these other organizations gave over $6 billion to Haiti for the relief effort, especially during the kind of natural disasters that you guys have gone through. Is that true?
No, it's more than true. The money is much more than $6 billion. You see, after the earthquake, countries around the world donate billions of dollars. The amount was much larger than $6 billion. And Bill Clinton was in charge of the money. And not only people around the world, but also American celebrities donate a lot of larger money to rebuild Haiti. And hundreds of homes were destroyed after the earthquake. And if you can believe, the people are still living under tents. That's unacceptable. And not only they held the money, they kept the money, but Haiti had enough resources for them to be very comfortable. Haiti have oil, more oil than Venezuela. Nobody's talking about. Haiti have gold. We have one of the largest gold mines in the Caribbean. So. And they let the world, nobody's saying anything about our goals. Yeah. And who do you think is in charge of our goal right now? The contract. Yeah. Tony Rodham, Hillary Clinton's brother.
Wow.
He's got a 26-year contract. And then also Haiti used to produce, we used to produce our own rice. We didn't have to buy rice overseas. Bill Clinton destroyed our rice so his brother can sell the rice from Arkansas.
Yeah, wow.
So they're doing a lot of things. Right now, if there's a millionaire or a billionaire who wants to do business in Haiti, they cannot do anything unless they check with the Clintons. The Clintons are the one who's running Haiti.
Yeah, wow.
And we are living in the 21st century. We are the first black people who liberated ourselves from the French rule. We fought three empires, the British, the Spanish, the French. So it's unacceptable for us to be occupied right now.
As we saw the investigations into where a lot of the relief funds for Haiti came into, and it ultimately went nowhere to the people but big multinational corporations, and a lot of the people who are still dealing with that natural disaster never got any relief because all the money that was funneled into them, even through the Red Cross, even through the Clinton Global Initiative, which the Clinton Global Initiative sometimes uses and brags, like, look, we helped out Haiti. We did this for Haiti. What did they do for Haiti, and what's the current situation there?
What have the Clinton, not only Haiti, what have the Clinton done with their foundation? They don't help anyone. They're just enriching themselves.
Okay. I know what I need to know about what's going on in Haiti. I've spent thousands of hours on the Haiti issue. This information should get out at some point. We should know the truth about all these NGOs, the Red Cross that took in over $500 million and only built six homes. Not expensive homes, little homes. Everyone who could exploit Haiti, including the United Nations and the Nepalese forces causing cholera, which led to thousands of deaths, and they denied it, only now acknowledging it. It's an occupied country. The Haitians deserve to have their freedom and to have the money that was promised go to the Haitians to rebuild their own country. That's what I'm saying. But that's an issue all around the world. Anytime there's a disaster anywhere, watch the people line up to profit off of it. Disaster capitalism, and it's unfortunate. Now, remember when I said that the media is very influenced by special interest groups, the deep state? They get their message out all the time. If you're a doctor, for example, and you happen to find that genetically modified organisms are bad, you can bet that any article you write and publish will be retracted. You can bet that you'll be personally attacked. You can bet that there'll be trolls 24/7 all over you. You'll no longer have the credibility you once had for simply telling the truth and engaging in decent science. Who's behind that? The media allows these people to have a forum to attack without first asking and doing their homework, was this person innocent or not? This is an example of proving that the CIA was and still is in the media business.
I thought that it was a matter of real concern that planted stories intended to serve a national purpose abroad came home and were circulated here and believed here, because this would mean that the CIA could manipulate the news in the United States by channeling it through some foreign country. Now, we're looking at that very carefully.
Do you have any people being paid by the CIA who are contributing to a major circulation American journal?
We do have people who submit pieces to American journals.
Do you have any people paid by the CIA who are working for television networks?
This, I think, gets into the kind of getting into the details, Mr. Chairman, that I'd like to get into in executive session.
At CBS, had been contacted by the CIA. As a matter of fact, by the time I became the head of the whole news and public affairs operation in 1954, ships had been established, and I was told about them and asked if I'd carry on with them.
We have quite a lot of detailed information, and we will evaluate it, and we will include any evidence of wrongdoing or any evidence of impropriety in our final report and make recommendations.
Do you have any people being paid by the CIA who are contributing to the national news services, AP and UPI?
Well, again, I think we're getting into the kind of detail, Mr. Chairman, that I'd prefer to handle in executive session.
Senator, do you think that you named the news organizations in your final report?
That remains to be decided.
I think it was entirely in order for our correspondents at that time to make use of CIA agent chiefs of station and other members of the executive staff of CIA as sources of information which were useful in their assessments of world conditions.
Would you say that continues today?
Well, I would think probably for a reporter it would continue today, but because of all of the...
Okay, there you have the former head of the major network news president saying, yeah. And it gets a lot worse. Our research has shown over 1,100 different news organizations have been using CIA. And in Hollywood, it's just rampant. For example, how do you think that some of the studios were able to get access to military equipment, access to soldiers? They had to prove the storyline. Take a look at some of these stories that make the CIA look good and make the U.S. government or its armed forces look good. And those are the ones the CIA are behind and support. That's how it works. So another issue is, how do we know that the media is ever being fully honest? We don't. That's where your own diligence and doing your research can make a difference. Now, let's say hello to Maria from Baltimore. Hi, Maria. Your turn.
Hi. Gary, thanks for taking my call. Hope I won't take too much time. Just ask a simple question. Should I turn off my power button on my TV so I can have privacy, or should I unplug the TV?
You have to unplug it because they have the capacity now to turn on or off any cell phone, any television, any electronic device where you're not aware of it. You would not be aware that they can be taking photographs of you with your own cell phone. You have to unplug the device if you want to have that freedom. Okay?
Okay. Thanks so much.
All the best.
Thank you.
Let's say hello to Carlisle from New York. Hi, your turn.
Hi, Gary. Well, it's the first time I've called and got through. I've been listening to you for quite some time now, and my life has proved to me one true thing, and that is when one chooses not to be personally responsible for their own life, no matter what is done for them, it will never change. A perfect example, I live in Arver, New York, right on the beach, and the property in which I moved into with my family, wife and four children, had a $60 million renovation. And for the life of me, a certain portion of the tenants have allowed their children to trample on the new greenery in which was planted, broken the gate to the community God knows how many times. And what I find is that this $60 million renovation that was done in hopes of changing the community, gentrification, so forth and so on. But it is the responsibility that the people lack. And I hold parents responsible more so than the children because they are raising them. And all the news that you present, one of the things I find is that it's great, it's informative, but when each person walks away, are they walking away saying, oh, well, I know this, I know that, or are they walking away saying, what am I going to do now that I've known this and I've known that? My son, who's 8 years old, all my children are vegetarians, they're all homeschooled, and this is a decision my wife and I made despite what came over the years, to stick with this because we are personally responsible for their upbringing, how they are raised, how they eat, how we live. And no matter what we find or where we find ourselves, one of the things that we always hold true to is that the decisions that are going to affect us the most are the decisions in which we find to be responsible over. And I just wanted to share that.
I appreciate that. I am one of those people who agree that we all have our personal responsibilities. We can't allow anyone else to be responsible for the choices we make, and we should be very concerned about the choices that are made on our behalf by other people and assume that there is no opportunity to have a discourse or share a dialogue about whether or not we feel that it was a correct or incorrect choice, just like going to war in Syria, going to war in look today at Libya. You know, no one's talking about the mess. You don't see any network going over there and say, here's what Hillary Clinton, Bill Clinton, the neocons in Washington created. Here's what the media championed. And go back and hear all the sound bites at the different networks and even people on the so-called left promoting the regime change, the militarization and imperialist overreach in Libya, for example. Now, go to Libya today. Show me the network, show me CNN or NBC, where they're going into Libya and saying on the left side of your screen is Libya before the invasion, no terrorism, women total had all the rights that men have, there was prosperity, the richest nation in Africa, 54 countries, universal health care, universal education, free, everything that a human being could ever expect or want from any country. Now look at it today. Over 200 different terrorist organizations operating, the country totally destroyed. If a network that promotes an invasion is not willing to take the time to show the mistakes they've made and the consequences of the people who live there, then that's a network we shouldn't believe at any future point. And think of the people you see on television as talking heads telling us what we should be doing, whether it's denying or accepting global warming. And then when they were wrong and we see the consequences, did we ever hear them say, I'm sorry, I made a mistake? Never. Therefore, why should we listen to them today? So on that measure, I believe that you're correct, that we lack in our society right now, especially in the majority of the younger generations, the X generation and the Y generation, the millennial generation, we lack that absolute sense of responsibility. There are about 10% who are responsible, but there's 90% who are not, and that only contributes to the obfuscation and the illusion that we are living an enlightened life. Thank you very much, Carl. And one more, Randolph from Canada. Randolph, your turn.
Gary, I'd like to congratulate the three representatives and the two senators that voted against sanctions. I really find it impossible to believe the majority of the people are in agreement with this possibility of war between several states and the United States. When Obama was elected, a lot of people throughout the world agreed with him. And the fact is, the first year he was totally discouraged because nothing was passing. So I believe that it's a light being shone for freedom, that these five people were courageous heroes to vote against the sanctions.
I agree. The sanctions are counterproductive. What you need is you need the truth. And the media refuses to tell us the truth about what happened in Ukraine and Russia and Hillary Clinton and Gloria Nuland and the other people who are part of the neocon right, who are benefiting tremendously into the hundreds of billions of dollars, the armaments industry. Every one of the bombs that have been used in Iraq and Syria, they profit from. And not a word about the 40,000 civilian deaths in the last 9 months since America started to so-called liberate. Well, take a look at a video. I posted a video at 4 o'clock this morning on my website, prn.fm, and my Facebook. You'll see a drone flying over the so-called liberated city. Every single building has been completely destroyed. It looks like Hiroshima after the bomb dropped. There is no discussion of the innocent civilians dead, how you're going to reconstruct all that, nor the fact that prior to Syria having any form of social conflict, you had the worst drought in Syria's history. Now, Syria was the breadbasket, and over 50% of all their farms had no water. As a result, the crops died, and they didn't get to market, so there was massive hunger. 2.5 million Syrians could no longer live in the destitute, parched land that they had historically been able to live at and grow foods on. So they migrated to the cities. This overburdened the cities because they weren't prepared for it. The administration was caught kind of off guard on this. And we saw an opportunity at the very same time this was happening, around 2011, 2009 to 2011, though the drought started as early as 2004, there was the Arab Spring. So we then had our smartest and best and brightest people get together and say, now it's an opportunity for regime change. After all, we've been wanting to change Syria and change Iran and change these other countries for at least 21 years. And we actually had it memorialized in documents, and people actually talked about it. Wesley Clark, the former commander of NATO, a 4- or 5-star general, said that he had a meeting where this was discussed right at 9/11. You know, this is who we're going to take out. Do they have anything to do with 9/11? Absolutely not. Well, if they have nothing to do with 9/11, why are we going to destroy their country? Because it was part of the neocon regime plans. So now they took advantage of it, and they, meaning the United States and Great Britain and France and Italy, put agent provocateurs, saboteurs, and mercenaries that we funded to the tune of over $1 billion. That's a matter of historical fact. And we then had rogue groups trained and stationed in primarily Turkey that would, and also Qatar was a part of this, and one of Al Gore's favorite countries, and also Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates. So all these countries, isn't it interesting that you never hear a word, not one word, spoken in Congress about the fact that Qatar, United Arab Emirates, Saudi Arabia, none of these countries that caused the social conflict have taken in one single refugee. Not one. Nor is Japan, for that matter. And for different reasons. And yet we don't talk about the things that are so clear and apparent and self-evident. So now you have all of these different destabilizing terrorist. There is no such thing, contrary to what John McCain had to say about these are moderates. There is no, you know, when you crucify someone, it's not moderate. When you're the fraudulent group, the white helmets, and you get all the nice liberals, you know, wanting you to get an Academy Award, and you do for a short documentary, and yet you're a terrorist organization. You're always there on the side of the terrorist. And there's footage of them right there when innocent people are being killed and them, you know, standing on bodies, and we've reported that on this program. So again, we're promoting disinformation propaganda. We're demonizing countries that did not deserve to be demonized. And then we go in there, and in Benghazi, that was the beachhead. That was the front where the, it wouldn't be in Tripoli, it'd be in, and that's where the terrorists began to shoot from rooftops the soldiers. And then the disinformation campaigns came. And through that disinformation campaign, finally leading up to, well, they used sarin gas. And yet it took the courageous and outstanding real journalist, Seymour Hersh, to show that it wasn't Syrian Assad that used the sarin gas. It was the terrorist, the ones we had been funding. And that's also true when we gave misinformation in Donald Trump. Could you imagine Donald Trump did not meet nor discuss with his Joint Chief of Staff nor with his military personnel information that they had that showed that Russia had notified under a joint agreement the United States military in that area and the Pentagon Defense Department that they were sending in the best number one pilot from Syria carrying a large bomb that was going to be dropped on a meeting of terrorist leaders, and they knew everything about the building. They knew, you know, where the different departments were. They were going to drop this bomb. And what they did not know is that there was nitrogen fertilizer in the basement. There was chlorine in the basement. And as a result, when they were told, this is the time we're dropping the bomb, here's who's dropping it, this is the course route they're taking. So our intelligence knew everything. And what we didn't know is that there would be a mixture of the chemicals in the basement that would come up. It was not sarin gas. It was not intentional, and it killed some innocent people. They did kill all four top military leaders of ISIS at that time. So what they chose to do was correct. The unintended consequences were something that they didn't anticipate. Now, all of the people knew this. The intelligence analysts knew that this was not sarin gas being dropped by Syria, because Syria didn't have any. The United States had made sure that all of the chemical weapons were taken away earlier, several years earlier. In any case, but that gave Donald Trump the opportunity, without any input, to go ahead and say, you know, they killed people. And then his UN person, this, you know, Nikki Haley, says, oh, you know, look at the babies. Once again, just like his Colin Powell, look at the babies, look at the death. They use sarin gas, they cross the line, they got to be punished. That's how irresponsible and reckless the media was, because they could have found out the things I just told you in detail. They have the sources, but they didn't want to counter him. As a result, imagine a man who is that impulsive, that petulant, that narcissistic, that misanthropic and misguided person. Now just imagine if he did something with Russia or China, because they have the capacity to retaliate. Now you see why we're so concerned about moving forward with a major anti-war movement, disarming our nuclear capacities around the world, and at least relying upon media that will give you an honest story instead of the ones that they're currently propagating out there. I appreciate your call, Randolph from Canada. Thank you. We're out of time. I'm going to save for tomorrow the other clips and the other commentaries. Always nice to be able to share this hour with you. Thank you. I look forward to sharing more tomorrow. Have a nice day.